the money, what will you use it for?
Oh, we have big plans. The Series C raise is great because it allows us to open up our biologics lab down the street. And the entire purpose of that is to prepare biologics formulations, so medicines, for flight in outer space. And the entire purpose of this is microgravity allows us to create new drug formulations that otherwise would be impossible to create on Earth. That's the whole purpose of Varda. And so with this Series C funding, we're able to build out a large lab space to vet those drug formulations before flying them and create an entire pipeline on the way to space.
Delian, I just want to point something out, which is that you are also a partner at Founders Fund. And this has worked exactly the same way that it always works. You recuse yourself from the round and you represent Varda, but they participated, as did Peter Thiel as an individual. Just to expand a little bit on what Will was saying, you know, one of the big changes that you guys have made over the last year is to start manufacturing yourself away from Rocket Lab, who used to do that as kind of the third party for you. Why is that significant, and how does that ramp look?
Yeah, I mean, they were, you know, sort of phenomenal partner, and we're deeply grateful, you know, to them in that they got us off the ground, you know, very quickly. But as we were looking to, you know, sort of scale up our cadence of flights and ability to truly control our supply chain, we had to go more full stack. And you see this in a variety of different aerospace companies where as they scale up, they tend to go more full stack over time. So that's going to allow us to, you know, fly four times next year. And then after that, ideally start doubling basically every single year and be able to control that doubling entirely in-house. And then it just expands the capabilities that we have on the spacecraft. In terms of, you know, biopharmaceutical production, by owning more of it, we're able to expand the capabilities of what we can have on board.
Will, Del's talking about all of the ramp in launch, getting to orbit. The big, beautiful benefit is zero gravity, right, in the pharmaceuticals context. But then you've got to get back down to Earth, and that's been one of the really exciting parts to track with Varda, the video in particular. Explain how that process works and also how it's going to go going forward.
Yeah, so you hit the nail on the head. The entire reason for going to space is for microgravity. It's just a fundamental force of physics that you can't change on Earth. You know, we don't want to go to space to have to make these new drugs. You just have to because of the laws of physics. And so our spacecraft allows us to do that quickly and cheaply. And a part of that is once we make those drugs in orbit, in microgravity, so that they're different than they would be made if they were on Earth, we have to bring them back. And that's certainly the most exciting part for the aerospace engineers here. You know, my background is also aerospace engineering. Like you said, the video is phenomenal. We hit the atmosphere going Mach 25. So that's 25 times the speed of sound, 27 times the speed that you go on a commercial airliner. And so you rip apart the atmosphere and you create this beautiful plasma of a shooting star for over a minute across the sky. It's beautiful on the way back.
The passion is real, Delian. The demand is real as well. I'm interested in the DOD and the government perspective here because we have seen so much more focus coming on space and defense more broadly.
Yeah, the, you know, sort of new Secretary of Defense, you know, in the early days of the Trump administration came out with what his national security priorities were, you know, sort of going to be. And amongst the, you know, sort of top three were nuclear weapons modernization, the development of next generation hypersonic capabilities and shipbuilding. And, you know, while Varda doesn't really, you know, sort of build ships, you know, we do, you know, help the DOD, you know, sort of with the other two and have a variety of different, you know, sort of collaborations across groups from the Air Force, Navy and NASA. What they're primarily interested in is, as Will mentioned, as we come into the atmosphere, we're going Mach 25. It's a regime that typically is very difficult to study on the ground and really understand what the flight dynamics will be like. And so you can think about the value proposition for Varda to the Defense Department as effectively like a hypersonic wind tunnel. They can attach net new materials, wing shapes, sensors onto the vehicle as we're coming in as a way to validate the subsystems sort of performance before they go and take that and integrate that into the ultimate sort of production system. And so by enabling faster testing, more frequent testing, cheaper testing, it allows us to expand on our capabilities and ideally both catch up to and surpass some of our near-peer adversaries like China and Russia that have demonstrated some pretty phenomenal hypersonic boost glide capabilities.
I also think that the competition is somewhat closer to home, or maybe it's a frenemy situation, Will. You have got such a broad experience. You've been flying the Dragon yourself when you were working at SpaceX. You've also worked in banking. You've founded your own venture fund in many ways. But Will, I ask you now, what is your biggest headache? Is it talent? Is it the race for talent? How do you expand?
Well, believe it or not, there's not that much competition in reentry because we're so much different than other commercial reentry vehicles like SpaceX's Dragon or Boeing Starliner. We are much small. We're off axis in almost every way. We're much smaller. We're higher cadence. We're not human rated, and we're lower cost. So it's more of a complementary situation. As far as headaches go, you know, a lot of them are gone now, thanks to a working spacecraft and funding to grow. It's more about enthusiasm and excitement here. I would say the challenge over the next couple of years is really to scale up that cadence, because as we scale cadence, we begin to look more and more just like a zero gravity oven to the pharmaceutical industry. They quite frankly don't care that we're going to outer space. They only care that we can deliver new drug formulations, and we just happen to have to do that by going to space and back. So the more often and the more frequent we can do that, the more easily it is for us to integrate into the pharmaceutical supply chain. And so that's the big challenge over the next couple of years, is increase cadence, fly more spacecraft, and develop more drugs on board.
Delian, the misconception maybe, or misunderstanding about what Will's talking about, ramping the cadence, is the cost consideration flying SpaceX on transporter missions. Actually, my understanding is it's not that great a cost. But would you talk a bit about the relationship and how it works, hitching a ride on Falcon 9?
Yeah, I mean, to give you a sense, like, of our total all-in mission costs, the, like, SpaceX, like, launch costs represent about 20-25% of our costs. So it's not, like, the, you know, majority or anything. It's also, you know, definitely one of the larger line items, but there's a lot of other things that go into operating, you know, sort of our business. Our business could not exist without the, you know, sort of Falcon 9 being reusable and that, you know, sort of transporter program. If you think about even, you know, sort of 5-6 years ago, your only real option to get up to orbit was having to buy a full dedicated rocket or find some way to squeeze yourself onto a large geosats, you know, sort of launch and, you know, be on board, but, you know, find your own way to orbit. Now, these transporter missions, they're doing them, I think, on the order of 3 times a year. They've started to add on, you know, different inclinations in orbit. They have these bandwagon missions that go to, you know, sort of polar orbit. Mm. And so it's been a really, you know, sort of critical, you know, sort of part of our ability to actually succeed as a business. I think there's just this interesting, you know, sort of pattern in technological history where when certain infrastructure layers get built up, it enables these net new, you know, sort of business opportunities, right? In some ways, for a business like Uber or Airbnb to get built, you kind of needed mobile to become very distributed and have the app store. And that's what really enabled those business models. We think of, you know, sort of the access to space and what SpaceX provides us is the same way. It's a fundamental infrastructure layer that enables our business, and it wouldn't have been possible, you know, sort of without them. And so we're thrilled to have them, you know, sort of as, you know, sort of partners, and, you know, have lots and lots of, you know, rockets, you know, sort of booked with SpaceX. I think, you know, we've booked out all the way through, I think, like Q3 27 or something like that.
You know, Will, we recognize here on Bloomberg Tech, there are many in the space industry who have looked to the defense apparatus of this country and the defense use case to kind of start to get off the ground because of grants and because of the availability of freedom to move. But long term, what is the business model? Who will your customers be when you're able to bring payload back down to Earth, pharmaceuticals developed in that zero gravity environment?
Yeah, it is a new technology. And what's cool, going to the defense aspect, and Delian hinted towards this, is that because reusable and commercial launch is a unique American asset, Varda is also a unique American asset on top of that. So it's almost a leapfrog above everyone else. And so we have this cool armada of small, low-cost, high-cadence reentry vehicles that can provide a service continuously for the Department of Defense as a hypersonic wind tunnel, like Delian mentioned. So to answer your question, what that means is now the Department of Defense can test things like sensors, new materials for heat shields. They can test flight computers and RF or radio frequency systems, navigation systems. So very similar to like a wind tunnel where it's acting as infrastructure so that the Department of Defense can advance new technologies faster and cheaper.